even though I feel that for many of us this is a sad day and a reflective day. And so we turn to our order of worship. Please stand. With all those who have gone before us, with all those who are around us, with Christians all over the world, we gather to offer our sacrifice of praise. We begin with hymn 32, Praise My Soul, the King of Heaven. Part of our shared life been taken from us, and it is so hard to take it in. Comfort and strengthen all of us who grieve for the Queen. Remind us of the faith that was her anchor and inspiration, and give us her trust in you to guide us through all the days of our lives. A reading from the scripture from Isaiah. Very well known passage. In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord sitting on a throne high and lofty, and the hem of his robe filled the temple. Seraphs were in attendance above him. Each had six wings, with two they covered their faces, with two they covered their feet, and with two they flew. And one called to another and said, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory." The pivots on the thresholds shook at the voices of those who called, and the house filled with smoke. And I said, "Woe is me, I am lost, for I am a man of unclean lips, and I live among the people of unclean lips. Yet my eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts." We know that passage so well, don't we? We don't often think of the context behind it. For many of us, I think 2022 will go down in our memory as the year that Queen Elizabeth died. And the death of our Queen has had a huge impact on us. Her face, her presence, her being part of our lives for so many years. There's probably more pictures of the Queen than any other person who ever lived, when counting stamps, coinage, yet alone the pages of newspapers, magazines and books. And for many of us too, she has been the only one that we can remember. She's been part of our lives, our imaginations, and she's given us a real sense of who we are. And strangely enough, the writer of this Bible passage from the book of Isaiah shared this experience of the death of a monarch. Uzziah had reigned for 52 years. He too had come to the throne young. He was only 16. And he, ruling for 52 years, died aged 68. A long time in terms of the kings of those ages. So it's probably no coincidence that in the year King Uzziah died, Isaiah had an experience of the ground shaking beneath him, when the temple shook and he felt lost. And I know that many of us feel quite dislocated and shaken up in ways we can't quite describe and perhaps hadn't expected. Somebody told me that they were crying. Others have said they find it hard to concentrate. And I have been constantly watching social media for new pictures and insights. But the monarch whose reign has just ended would be the first to say that the God whom she worshipped and to whom she committed her life in service was the Holy God, the Holy God who is with us now, and that whole earth is filled with God's glory, as it was then, as it is now, and as it will be. Many would say that she provided, above all, a sense of stability and reassurance. When times were painful and difficult, she was there. She always sought to comfort the suffering and to steady the anxious, even when she didn't quite read the mood of the nation. And so we expected warm words from our leaders. We certainly expected it from new leaders of the unionist side of the community. But it has
Pierre Trudeau's words were so moving from Canada. But it surprised me, talking to the European bishops, who meet on Zoom every 2 months, and their bishops from the Netherlands, Switzerland and Germany. It was obvious too, the honour in which they held her as well. One of the bishops said, she was a queen for Europe. And another related how he had spent 3 hours watching the television and programmes about her on Thursday evening. She hasn't really just been the queen for these islands, for our nation, for the Commonwealth. She's been a symbol of stability and faith for people across the world. So we've been very blessed to have her as our monarch. And as Christian people too, we've been very blessed to have someone who has such a deep faith in God, a faith which was sure and strong. She spoke with increasing depth in her many Christmas broadcasts about her reliance on God. She often quoted the parable of the Good Samaritan. Apparently she used that 3 times. She spoke and acted in very quiet ways, in ways of reconciliation. And in 2014, she said this in her Christmas message. This is the time of year, she said, when we remember that God sent his only Son to serve and not to be served. He restored love and service to the centre of our lives in the person of Jesus Christ. It is my prayer this Christmas day that his example and teaching will continue to bring people together to give the best of themselves in the service of others. The carol, In the Bleak Midwinter, ends by asking a question of all of us who know the Christian story of how God gave himself to us in humble service. What can I give him, poor as I am? If I were a shepherd, I would bring a lamb. If I were a wise man, I would do my part. And she went on to say, the carol gives the answer. Yet what can I give him? Give him my heart. So in the year that Queen Elizabeth died, we give thanks for a life of dedicated service to our nations and Commonwealth and our world. We give thanks to God's faithful servant Elizabeth. We pray for her family and closest friends, for all who will mourn and miss her. We grieve for what we have lost, and we take heart and hope from the faith that we shared with her and she shared with us, remembering that death is defeated and that God reigns above all. So may the Queen rest in peace and rise in glory. Before we turn to our prayers, I want to share with you not all of the comments, but it has been lovely to have the church open for people to come in and pray and reflect and leave messages if they want to. And people have left some very moving messages. I will collect them all up and we'll display them at some point, but just a flavour of them. The only monarch I've ever known was an incredible servant to her people. I will always remember your smile, your blue eyes and your sense of fashion. A beautiful, kind and sincere lady. Thank you for your service, Mom. Thank you for a lifetime of service, someone else writes. A truly amazing lady who will be greatly missed by many people throughout the world. I will miss you. By Mar, age 8. What a wonderful lady with an amazing faith. Remember her with fondness. She had a great sense of humour too. We'll never forget her participation in James Bond and Paddington's sketches, which brightened up her day. Thank you, Queen Elizabeth, for just being you. Sad time, but you're in a better place now. by our Sovereign Elizabeth over 70 years. We thank you also for her commitment to people across our nation, Commonwealth, and across the world. Her willingness to travel to meet people and reach out across divisions of faith, language, politics, and ethnicity. Her patronage of so many charities and good causes. The stability and values that she represented in our changing world. Her long marriage and commitment to her family. Her Christian faith and her willingness to speak of that faith. May we reflect on these gifts to us and seek to emulate her service in our lives. We pray for comfort for the royal family as they grieve privately for their mother, grandmother and great-grandmother. May they know your strong arm underneath them as they navigate their own emotions and the new circumstances that they face. Be with them as they face the public duties ahead of them and their grief shared with the nation and Commonwealth. We pray too for comfort for all the staff in royal homes and offices who have served the Queen so faithfully over so many years. We pray for our new King Charles III. Give him comfort in his grief, the spirit of good counsel and holy wisdom that he will need for his new role as our King. Patience over matters large and small in his personal life and in matters of state. A love for his people in this nation and in the Commonwealth. Gifts of love and joy and peace as he serves us and you. Your abundant grace. And this we pray through the name of Jesus Christ, who is the King of Kings. Amen. Prayer for the nation. Almighty God, hear us as we pray for the leaders of the nation, the King, the Prime Minister and the Ministers of State, all members of Parliament, those in local government and community leaders, that they may be guided by your wisdom and be humble in the service of your people. Amen. We stand to sing number 229, Brother, Sister, Let Me Serve.
Thank you.
now we will have our Bible.
To sing, all people that are on earth do dwell. It's number 349. This hymn was sung at the late Queen's coronation. All people that on earth do dwell.
Thank you.
found acceptable in your sight. O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. In a way, the last set of readings from the letter to the Hebrews and the associated readings with it is perhaps, for me anyway, the best set of, or one of the best sets of readings we could have for today. As you know, because we wanted to finish looking at the book of Hebrews, we're now 2 weeks out of kilter with the lectionary that's printed in the watchwords. But I think today it served us very well. Psalm 112 could have been written for the Queen. When you look through it, it's about someone who has feared the Lord and found great delight in the Lord's commands. Happy are those who fear the Lord, who delight in his commands. And if you go home and read it, you'll see so many other verses there that reflect what the Queen has meant. They rise in the darkness as a light for the upright. They're gracious, merciful, and righteous. Now, no one is perfect. And we should never pretend that, or attempt to gloss over things. But some people do set a great example for us. And she was one of those. I just want to read verse 9. They've distributed up their righteousness and endures forever. Their horn is exalted in honour. And I think we know that the memory of our late Queen will last for many, many years, and that she will be spoken of in honour for years to come. So do go home and read Psalm 112. It's a great psalm for us all to strive to achieve. And then our passage from the letter to the Hebrews. And so much of the letter to the Hebrews is about the heavenly realm. It's about ideas, concepts, thoughts of heaven. And this week, it is so wonderfully earthed in the practical stuff of life. And I think that's very much what you could say for the life of the Queen. A deep faith, but earthed in the here and now, about how we treat our neighbours, our families, and those who are different from us, those who come to different backgrounds. So I'm just very brief, because in many ways, it's completely obvious when you read the passage, how we are supposed to live, the way our faith is supposed to express it in our lives. It begins with saying, let mutual love continue. Or literally, it talks about love each other as brothers. Some Bibles put it, love each other as brothers and sisters. It's about, within the Christian community, loving each other as members of our own family. Looking around, we're all so different, but we belong together, and we should be loving each other as we belong together. Of course we have our differences, the times we don't agree, but love for each other should stand above and beyond anything else. They will know we are Christians by our love. Then talks about hospitality to strangers. Now this was so important in the ancient world because you really did not want to stay at an inn if you were travelling, if you were a Christian, moving about the country, staying in places. In the time of Jesus and the Roman Empire, inns were not good places to stay. Expensive and could lead you into all kinds of trouble. Not like Aaron, dear Bishop, I was talking to him yesterday on the phone, and he stayed in a lovely pub in Northumberland. It wasn't like that in Jesus' day and the years after. So it was really important that Christians looked after other Christians who were travelling round and about. And the reason we had an inn in our village as Moravians was so that there could be a good and decent place for people to stay when they came to the settlement, when they brought their children to the schools, or when they came to bring goods here, or to buy goods from here. Inns, good and decent inns, were important and part of the Moravian tradition. Somebody's just written a paper on Moravian inns, and we have more information to chipped mug, sat in the kitchen, is a great gift of love. And it's also about welcoming the strangers in our midst, the people who are not like us, who are not part of our group. What welcome do we give to them? I'm sure you all know the parable in Matthew chapter 25 that Jesus tells of the sheep and the goats. And people say, well, we didn't recognise you when we fed you. We didn't recognise you when we came to you in prison. It's the fact that you showed it to the least of the one us these. And in Genesis chapter 18, the writer to the Hebrews is looking back to this instance where Abraham and Sarah welcomed travellers into their tent and looked after them, not knowing that they were angels bringing message from God that Sarah was to have a son in her old age. So we do not know people's stories. We do not know the back or the front. But we are to make people welcome, to make them feel at home, not just within the community that we know, but the strangers around about us. And this is a huge political challenge to us in the time of refugees and immigrants. How do we make the stranger feel welcome? Might they be the angel in our midst? So these are verses that are a very current challenge to us. And then it talks about remember those in prison. Now, here, this was a context where people were being imprisoned for their faith. But they could also be in prison because they were in debt, because they'd got into trouble. These are people within the Christian community, in prison for faith, in prison because of poverty, unable to pay debts, in prison for all sorts of reasons. And the Christian community was called to remember them and to remember all people who are mistreated. And what does that mean to us today, 2,000 years on? We need to remember that there are still people imprisoned for their faith in other lands and people who are persecuted for their faith in other lands. And that may be things like not getting the chance to go to university or not getting the jobs or being kept down in the very lowest parts of society. But we need to think wider too. Those who are imprisoned by illness and circumstance. And those who are imprisoned rightly. It's a terrible thing to be in prison. Never make light of it, even if it is deserved. It is a terrible thing to have your liberty taken away. So we can remember to pray for our justice system and for our prison system. And then it goes on to talk about marriage, to be honoured. It is so obvious for us as Christians. And there's a great line in our wedding liturgy. And it says that marriage is appointed for the well-being of human society, which can be stable and happy only when the marriage bond is honoured and upheld. It's not just about us and our relationships, it's about the good of society too. So, we are to take care in our relationships. And we're to be free from the love of money. Where have you heard that before? Jesus says, give unto Caesar that which is Caesar's, and to God what is God's. And Paul writes in 1 Timothy, the love of money is the root of all evil. It is a terrible thing to want more and more and more. And we live in a very frightening world where some individuals have more wealth than sovereign nations. Where some individuals can influence the way that nations behave, where some individuals with great wealth hold sway over so much. The love of money is a terrible thing, and as Christians we should constantly be aware of that in our wider social life, but also in our own personal lives. In those days, for Christians, many were very, very poor. Many have had to flee because of their faith. And we are right to remember even now to pray for those who don't have enough and to pray for a society where everybody has enough, as well as praying that people wouldn't be greedy. The next verse is the words of such confidence, because they're words that tell us we are not alone. The writer says, or quotes, "I will never leave you or forsake you." And then he quotes again, "The Lord is my helper, I will not be afraid. What can anyone do to me?" These are words telling us that we're not alone, that God is with us. John Wesley's famous words were, "And the best is, God is with us." He was reflecting on the incarnation. And then, of course, after the ascension, the Holy Spirit descended as Jesus ascended. Jesus said we would not be left as orphans because we would have the Holy Spirit. God is with us even now. And the Lord is with us when just two or three gather in his name. We have the Holy Spirit with us day by day. Our problem is not that we are left alone. Our problem is that we don't remember we are not alone. It goes on, the passage goes on to say, remember your leaders. Well, today we are particularly honouring the Queen and all that she has meant to us and all that she has given to us throughout her life. It's hard to believe, isn't it? A life where there is no retirement, where you just keep going, a life of duty. On a Tuesday, you say goodbye to one Prime Minister and meet another. And at 96, no time of rest, no time of finish, until the final rest. So we're right to honour the Queen. But we're also right to remember all who have blessed us with their guidance through our lives. And I think particularly of Sunday school teachers and of youth leaders and the influence that they have on our young people. Honour them. Give them respect and pray that we will have new junior church leaders, children's church leaders, because they are just as much ministers of the word as a minister, because they guide our young people. And then verses 15 and 16, to offer God praise and do good. It's a lovely balance. The two things carefully balance. God is owed our sacrifice of praise. Whatever we feel like. That's why I so love the first hymn in our service. We owe God that sacrifice of praise each and every day. And the thanksgiving that he gives us breath, that he's given us our lives. But balanced to that is the doing good, that we prove the validity of our faith in the way that we live. And then going back to that famous verse, Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today and forever. It's that sense of continuity. Jesus hasn't changed. In a changing world, we can depend on him. And I think it's part of what we feel with the loss of the Queen. Keir Starmer put it very well when he said, we've lost that still centre. And that's how many of us feel with her death. The continuity and a sense of the past and hope for the future is so important to us. I think that's part of the reason why folk are so drawn in by family history. They want to know where they've come from, where their ancestors used to live, what the home place was. They love looking back to get that sense of the past, to feel rooted. But we have still centre. We have a rock. We have a cornerstone and a sure foundation on which to base our lives. And it's the same rock, the same cornerstone, the same foundation on which our Lady Queen based her life. So we could do no worse than to trust in Jesus for today and for tomorrow. Or as the Queen said in 2014, to give him our heart. Once we've done that, then to lead lives worthy of that profession of faith. Amen. Stand to sing again. Number 334. Let us build a house where love can dwell. Sing verses 2 and 2 and 4 and 5. Sorry. seeing those we have known over the passing of time, those we have grown to know, to love and to trust. When we look further, when we look outside, we see others, strangers whom we know superficially by face, but not by name. By name, perhaps, but not by depth. When we look inside us, we see the mixed motives, the best desires of our hearts, but also prejudice, fear and doubt. When we dare not explore beneath the superficial, give us courage. When we are fearful of being open with others, give us confidence. When we retreat behind the closed doors of our churches, give us strength. When we judge by appearances, forgive us. When we do not see you in others, forgive us. When we close the circle of our love, of your love, forgive us. Help us to build healthy community for the world's sake. When we give in to shallow judgments to protect our own territory and keep our lives safe. When we would live our lives within the church and forget your call to engage with the life of the world. Send us out with words of hope. So, Lord, make us sensitive yet brave. We pray for prisoners and those who have experienced prison life, especially those who are rootless and homeless. Lord, make us sensitive yet brave. We pray for leaders in all works and walks of life, for people in government, particularly the civil service, for those in service organisations, for religious leaders in all faiths. Lord, make them sensitive yet brave. We pray for all concerned to encourage and support marriage and family life. We pray for strong commitment and generosity to those seeking a place to call home. Lord, make us sensitive yet brave. Help us to do good and to share what we have, even with those who suffer and struggle in different cultures and countries. Lord, make us sensitive yet brave. Let us continually offer a sacrifice of praise to God through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Our final hymn, 378, Lord for the earth.
Thank you.
to us and God's servants, life everlasting. The blessing of God Almighty.